because no, I don't think they are wooden. No, because in physics it is working like this. If I close the door, internet is not arriving to my studio. I don't know if you can see my screen. I hope it will be present in the recording, but in any case, I can arrange. Okay, so this is a review of the history of computing, and essentially I used a few books that I shall send to you here in the presentation that I will upload somewhere in the teaching site. I shall send you an email. So there is a new history of modern computing, which is a quite comprehensive review of the history of computing up to 2020 about. And there is also this other history of the information machine, which is also possible to read also in Italian. This code by Charles Petzold is quite interesting because it starts from any kind of code at the beginning, so say Morse code, ASCII code, and so on, to develop the idea of, say, looking at computer from the inside. And actually, as we shall see probably in the second lesson, it also has the ambition of describing how to somehow build up a computer at home, starting from scratch. A thing which is, I do not suggest to do this because it's quite a long history, but that is an interesting point of view. Then there is also this book, which is quite interesting from the historical point of view. It is about Italy and personal computer. Then this again is a book that suggests how to build up a modern computer from first principle, including also the operating system and so on. This is a rather technical book in Springer, so publisher, which is essentially a course. And then for the last lesson, I would present some aspect about artificial intelligence, deep learning. But from the other side, from the political point of view, this is another interesting book, and it talks about the fight for, say, controlling the cheap technology. And this is still a crucial point now. For instance, we have seen what happened just a few weeks ago with the failure, no, of a Taiwan chip manufacturing factory and the consequences of all the world. And okay, so the idea is to try to find a focus in each part of the history. So essentially, we shall see that we start with computers as a scientific tool, and then with the increase of technology, it will be used as, say, an interactive computer, and then communication take place, and then we shall see how games and some of the appliance market will determine and will promote the growth of computer up to, say, nowadays, ubiquitous computer, artificial intelligence, and so on. Okay, so the word computer actually it is quite old, but it refers to something like this. This is a room full of computers at the beginning of the century, and This is, for instance, another one from the North American Aviation in Los Angeles in the 50s. And so you see that actually these are essentially all using, say, calculator and machines. And here, too, a couple of them have something more sophisticated, but most of them are just performing computing calculations. And indeed, from the Oxford English Dictionary, a computer is one who computes, so essentially a human. And clearly, the idea of computing, which means essentially producing tables of numbers, is quite old. For instance, this is a tablet from, say, some 19th century before Christ that contains a list of Pythagorean triples, no? I mean, like 3, 4, and 5, no? Because they were essentially quite useful for building a right angle, because if you take a rope and you divide the rope according to these proportions and you tend essentially the rope, they form automatically a right triangle. And since Pythagorean triples are hard to be found by enumerating all numbers, clearly a table like this has a certain advantage because it saves time. And we shall see at the end that this idea of hard tasks that have to be computed or have to be selected beforehand is also used today. And clearly, the main advantage of a table is to ease calculations. I think you all know, when I was young, we were obliged to use logarithm at least sometimes to perform calculations. Clearly, they were already not very used, but we were tough how to use the logarithmic rule. So the idea is that the logarithm is a nice device to perform a multiplication because they transform a multiplication into sums. And clearly, the problem is that, okay, suppose you have to multiply to give to big numbers, these 5,432 and these 126, 34. Okay, you take the logarithm, say you can scale, so I'm using base 100, I mean, I'm using base 10, but then I divide by 2. And so you have these two numbers, and then you have to find that you can add easily them up, but then you have to find the number C such that this is its logarithm. So clearly, you can just look in the table and find the nearest number, which is this one. So instead of the right answer. And then maybe you can use interpolation, as you know, essentially you can first, you have this, say these two numbers, x1 and x2, you can first simply take the proportion among them, it means linear interpolation, or if you have more numbers at your disposal, you can have some more sophisticated interpolation, and this is what people used to do, say, at the beginning of the last century, essentially. But logarithms are one thing which is clearly interesting, but logarithm is a one-shot task, because once you have computed the logarithm, you are okay forever. But there are a lot of other tables that are needed and that may vary during, say, time. For instance, one is the table of tides, that were essentially useful in order to avoid, say, to get stuck into some shore, to enter harbors, to enter rivers and so on. You need to have a table of tides, let's say when there is a high tide, so you can enter somewhere, so avoid obstacles and so on. And this table can be computed by hand, so essentially integrating the motion of the moon and also using other kind of approximations. And they have to be computed a lot of times. So actually what the companies that did this by, so as their job, did in the beginning of the century, of the last century, was to have at least two contractors to compute the entries of the table, and then an adjudicator that checked the consistency of the tables. Most of them were not professionals. Most of them were, for instance, teachers that after math used, since they were at hand with the computation, they used to perform this kind of computation. And here Babbage enters, because Babbage was clearly a person who was interested in many things. One of them was about using tables, and actually he was visiting France when Deprony wanted to essentially increase the level of taxation of French citizens. And in order to do that, they needed to have a land registry table more accurate. This is also a thing that here in Italy is something which is, say, which arises the opposition of many to have the land registry table accurate, because this would mean to show the real value of one's house and so on. And this Deprony, since we are essentially at the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, he was inspired by the idea of division of labor, to have, say, a factory of data production. And so the idea is to have, let's ask some famous mathematician like Legendre and Carnot to set up the algorithm, and then the actual working with numbers can be done by, say, trained people, but not mathematicians, not specialized people. You can find a lot of, say, normal or maybe specialized, but not extremely selected people able to perform calculations. And so, since this was a way of automating the calculation, Babbage, which was again in the mood of say replacing handwork with machines, started to think how to automatize the computation. There is at the time there was already some way of making a computation, for instance, the Pascal machine that we shall see in the following was a way of making addition, simply turning the wheels and so on. And this also inspired a lot the differential engine of Babbage. So the idea is to have something that mechanically can do sums, essentially sums, and by turning wheels and so on, and then print the result. So essentially this is the main idea of the difference engine, but the problem is that in order to be accurate, it needed quite a precision, especially because at the time they were not using as we do Boolean numbers. They tend to use decimal numbers. So this means that anything has, say, 10 positions, a disk has 10 positions and so on. And so you have to be quite accurate in order to say discriminate between one, two, and three, and so on. This is clearly simpler if you have just two positions, but this was something that arrived after that. The problem for Babbage was that he received money, funds for developing this machine, but at a certain point he started to think that one could have a programmable machine, because clearly these kind of machines are an improvement with directed by a simple, for instance, a Pascal machine in which the human has to decide what to sum and then take note of the number and insert it again. This kind of machine can perform a series of, say, computation, but you have to change the wires, change the mechanism in order to do another computation. While the idea of the analytical engine, which was the next step of Babbage, was to have something that can be programmed, I mean, that in somewhere has a program stored in some places. Another, before going to the analytical engine, we have to also to dive a bit into the spirit of the time, in which calculation were, in some sense, restricted to specialized fields. One of them was this chamber of bankers clearing, in which it existed only in London. And so the idea was that any bank at that time used the cash. Cash were extremely used, not cash, the money, but the cash in the sense of the piece of paper in which you write down the amount. Because clearly people did not want to circulate with a lot of money in their pocket, and clearly these kind of transactions were common also in the Renaissance. The problem is that each bank has their own check, and so the problem is that if now I'm bank number one, I have check from bank number two, three, four, and five, and they have my check, how can we compensate the transaction without bringing money down and forth? So the idea was to have this kind of arrangement in which the representative of any bank, and then other clergymen going around depositing into each box the cash is related to the one and signing the virtual transaction. And so at the end, each bank can take the balance of how many check they have received and the others. And so finally, just passing the money. And clearly the next step was to have a national bank in where each bank had their own account, and so also this compensation was made virtual simply by taking note of the change. And another technology that will influence a lot the development of computer was the telegraph, because again in this case clearly the telegraph is the big invention of the 18th century, now in which they can start sending messages in all the country in just a few minutes. But at the beginning, clearly, you had the lines connecting a point to another point, Birmingham to Manchester, and then Leeds to London, and so on. And you can imagine that the next problem was, how can I send a message to Glasgow from London if I don't have a line going from London to Glasgow? Clearly, I can send a message to Birmingham and then ask Birmingham to pass it to, I don't know, Edinburgh, and then Edinburgh to Glasgow. The idea is that it started to be elaborated, the idea of routing, I mean, founding the path that can be either the fastest, either that avoids, say, a cut in some line, or the cheapest, because maybe if you take a longer run, but you can use, say, stations that are not very used, but no, and so they make cheap they allow cheap transmission of messages. I don't know, I think that this can be kind of problems that are now also present. Finally, you see that they decided to have a hub in London, which has simplified a lot the transmission. So the idea is to, everybody has to send something to London, and then London can redirect messages to some other places. Okay, and finally, another big push towards informatization was the census in the US mid of the 19th century. And the census in the United States was extremely important because it was essentially included in the Constitution of the United States that says that everybody who is paying taxes has to be represented in the parliament. This was also the cause of the revolution of the United States. The colonies had no representative in the London parliament, but they do not pay taxes, and so this was compensation. When the English parliament tried to impose a tax on the tea, there was the tea revolution, when people from the United States camouflaged by Indians, by Native American, no, entered the ships and threw the pack of teas to the sea. And this was the starting of the American Revolution. And so essentially, it was extremely important to have a count of how many people there were in each state, because for the low chamber in the United States, the number of seats are proportional to the number of people, not for the high, for the Senate. In this case, every state counts for two, but independent of how big they are. The idea was developed by Hermann Hollerith, that had the idea of using punched card. It made the cards the same size of a $1 bill, because this was simpler to archive all of this, because they used essentially the same mechanical archive used for bills. And it was also inspired by the fact that at that time the train ticket contained a kind of description of the people. So essentially contained clearly the route, because you had to pay according to the distance, the time of the day, because there were crowded time, which was very more expensive, and moreover, because in such a way you can say that the ticket is valid for a certain amount of time. But they were also afraid of the fact that the people could pass the ticket to another when exiting. So they had a way of classifying the shape, so if it was male, female, with bear, without bear, with a hat, without a hat, and so on. And so by punching this description, this digital photograph, in some sense, of the customer, they could avoid having people passing the ticket to other people. And so the idea, Hollerith so called the census as a national punch photograph, so that you can see here that essentially the card for the census contained the day clearly, but also some indication of people, if they were belonging to a large family, to a small families, and so on. And the card had the advantage that they could be read by an electrical device which simply had contacts for all possible holes. And so just counting how many holes were performed on the card, you can had counters that count the simply the amount of holes in a given column and row of the cards. So this was essentially this large number of watches counted how many holes were in the first position in the top row, and so on and so on. While these things that is in the left part of the table is the machine for doing holes. Then another important thing that influenced and still influences our computer world is the writing machine, the typewriter, no? In order to typewrite the things, which was developed in the, say, from the mid to the end of the 19th century, and which has proven to allow to type faster than handwriting. And clearly, I don't know if it is really a legend or a truth, but the idea is that they started having letters arranged in alphabetical order, but then it was realized that in this way typists were too fast, and they tend more than too fast, they tended to press two neighboring letters too often, and this would say had intertwining of the hammers, no? Because they have to rise before the other came back to their position. So the order was crumbled around in order to separate letters. But you can notice that still in the middle of the keyboards, there is a line which is in alphabetical order. This F, G, H, J, K, L is the remnant of the original order of the keyboard. And clearly another thing is the derivation of the Pascal machine, which were other machine essentially, and could perform also multiplication simply by turning a sufficient number of times the wheel. And they also, the important point was that they were able to print the result, because this was what interested in accounting. And all these names, Remington, Burroughs, are names that will come back in the first era of computers. Similar to the calculator machine was the cash register machine, which was also quite important because it was pervasive in all shops essentially. And this it is important not because of the complexity of my machine, but because the company who was sold the most of this machine with this national cash register was essentially centered on the attention to the client. So having quick repair and substitution of machines that were not working. And this was inspired by the Singer way of, say, taking care of customers and ensuing machines. So they also developed a method that was then copied by IBM, for instance, to have courses for sellers. You cannot improvise to sell this kind of machine. You had to know each of them, advantages and so on, to say provide full life assistance, having so proposing changes, improvement and so on, having prizes for best sellers and so on. And so all of these things will be say copied by IBM. This is the CEO of IBM, Thomas Watson, with his so motto above think before doing anything. And he essentially copied in a very simple way, because he was a top national cash register salesman, and when he wanted to found his own, so he was it was the national cash register then decided to become IBM when they started to mechanize the things. And clearly, there was also a way of practicing, say, a kind of dumping. So in some sense, for instance, they used to sell cash register at a lower price than market in areas where there were competitors, so that to bring them out of the market. And when they were left alone, they could finally rise the price of the machines, which was also the occasion for a charge. And so essentially the machine that was used in the census was the basis of IBM. So essentially how to count automatically these cards. So this was the Tabulated Machine Company. And so essentially Watson, which was fired by CTR, which was fired by CTR and hired by this Tabulated Machine Company. So he brought the method of CTR in the national, and this is a Tabulated Machine Company, which then became International Business Machine. And so the business was that of having this kind of machines here, which was simply a machine that who either counted the holes in the punch of the cards or sorted them into packs according to some hole, to some combination of holes. And this part that you see in the lower left zone was essentially a box full of wiring that determine the conditions for which a hole should be counted or not, or the card has to be put in one box or in another. So essentially here you can have, if you open, maybe there is an illustration in some other slide. Here you had, say, essentially a lot of connectors that produce a signal when some hole was punched in the car or not, and another set of connectors that said if the card had to go in the left or in the right bunch. And then you can, by manually wiring the things, you can say, okay, cards that contains holes in the position 1, 2, and 3 and not in position 4 and 5, and they go to the right, the others go to the left. And the idea is that, see, this was the program essentially of this machine. And the idea is that instead of wiring everything each time that you use this machine, you could remove this part, store it somewhere, and put in the new one, so that essentially changing the rewire. But the business of IBM was not selling this machine. Actually, they were not sold, they were rented. But the idea is that they were the only one who produced the cars with the right quality, because they needed a very, very big factories to have a large number of cars with the right quality. And so the income of business for many, many times, for many, many years, was that of selling cars instead of selling or renting this kind of machine. The same as Kodak. Kodak did business with films and not with the cameras. And so let's come back to Babbage. Babbage, having all this stuff more or less at the hand, he started considering how to program a machine, and he decided to copy the mechanism used in the loom by Jacquard, who were able to alter the rising of the wires in order to produce a drawing in the tissue using punched cards. Essentially, the cards are this one. You can see holes. Holes mean lowering of rising some level, some of these wires here that would put the, say, a color above or below the surface. And so by having a lot of these cards or cards arranged in a loop, you could repeat or perform a drawing or repeat the same drawing line after line. And so essentially the dream of Babbage was to build a machine, a large machine, and that in the core was a differential engine, so something that could perform essentially addition of numbers. But in some other places there were these programs, these loom, these cards, like in the loom, that were able to decide what kind of operation on which data could be done. And think that in this first design, who was never completed, Babbage already had the idea of a stored program, of separating instruction from data, and of having conditional branches. The interesting thing is that Babbage clearly was disappointing his government because he promised a machine for making a computation and never arrived to the end. Then he asked more money to build something was extremely also difficult to describe because there were no words at that time available to describe a programmable machine. And so he was, started traveling and was also invited to in Turin because King Vittorio Emanuele was extremely pushing a lot. He's a newborn, almost a newborn, in the sense of the king of Sardinia is in the time that he won this new territory. And so he wanted to improve the role of this kingdom in the... He was, I don't know if you know the history of the kingdom of Piedmont and the kingdom of Sardinia, but it was extremely assisted by England because essentially it was a way of avoiding the penetration of France in Italy and from one side, and the penetration of the empire, the Roman Empire, so the empire of Germany or Austria, on the other side. So he was exactly in the middle, no? Because from one side, Milan belonged to the first of the sometimes to the Spanish, sometimes to the Habsburg in Austria. From the other side, there was France. Piedmont was in the middle, so it was an interest of England to have a strong Piedmont kingdom. And so they assisted a lot this small kingdom, and one of these assistants was to have Babbage, or maybe it was independent, but they had a strong connection to talk with Luigi Menabrea, who later was the prime minister of Italy. And Menabrea wrote a report on the machine, which was later in Italian, clearly. It was later translated in English by Ada Lovelace, the daughter of Byron, who also described the first program that could be implemented in this never produced analytical engine. And so there are only drawings of this analytical engine. And so you can see the idea was to have essentially say, mechanic transmission of information by means of gears that could say elaborate information. But maybe I have to switch, first of all, to switch to power otherwise. But maybe if I share the whole screen and not just this window, I can show you also internet. So let me first connect the computer and then change the sharing. Okay, so let me stop the presentation and share the whole screen. Okay, I hope you can see my screen. Maybe I can remove unnecessary things. Can you see my screen? Because I don't see it. Yes, okay. So we don't see anything but that. So if you go to this Fermilab, which is not the Fermilab, but Fermilab now is closed. So Fermi means ant in French. It has a lot of interesting piece of information, but also the emulator of the analytical engine, if I'm able to find it. But the history and nostalgia, I think the analytical engine here. And so let me see if anybody wants to enter. I don't see. I heard somebody maybe wanting to enter, or maybe just. Okay, I don't know what is it, but maybe probably somebody trying to chat with me, but okay. And so in this here you can see a lot of document, like the text by Menabrea and the report, and also the emulator of the analytical engine. Clearly, the language is somehow invented, because it was never described in full. But if you want to play, like if you were in the novel by Crichton, the difference engine, no? If I remember well, there is a science fiction by the difference engine book. This one, I think, William Gibson and Bruce Sterling. This is a novel in the 19th century about where they suppose that the analytical engine has been built. So you have steam computers that can transform the Victorian age into an information age, and this is a kind of say police history about the stealing of a pack of cards that contained a program that I don't remember what what was in. And there is also Ada Lovelace there and Babbage, who are part of the novel. Okay. So the idea of a programmable engine is that to have an algorithm, which is not a new term. Algorithm comes from the Renaissance, from Arab, which means to make a computation. But you can see from here, this is just computing the greatest common divisor of two numbers. And the idea is that for doing these kind of things, you need to have some branch, so some instruction like if then go to, for instance, that allows you to perform the same calculation over and over up to a certain condition, not for a certain given number of times, but up to a given condition. This seems something extremely, say, intuitive, but actually took a lot of time to be implemented in a computer, because the first use of computer were to compute to integrate the differential equations, essentially, because this was also essentially the origin of say computation, advanced computation. Newton had to invent the method for integrating a differential equation to compute the trajectory of say planets around the sun. But clearly the main application was to compute the trajectory of shells, of artillery shells in war. And while there are techniques that allow to integrate by hand some limited number of linear, so essentially all linear differential equations and a very limited number of nonlinear differential equations, you can have, say, algorithm for integrating a differential equation step by step. For instance, the simplest one is Bernoulli, the fixed step integration, Euler, computation, so that instead of the limit of disk that defines the derivative, you take a finite increment. And then you can have you can compute the next value of something simply throwing away the limit and computing the next value given the present one, its derivatives in this point, and the variation. Clearly, this has some error. You have to keep delta x small. And this means that you have to do a lot of computation in order to advance. And another related field is that of computing integrals, which again is the task of starting from some point and adding small increments. And again, one can also see that if one is able to do one of these two tasks, it is also able to do the other task. And so essentially this is the reason of why you want to integrate, because very rarely you have the opportunity of finding an explicit solution of your equation. Most of time you have to integrate step by step. And the other interesting point, which is used in some kind of computation, is the analog computation. I mean, you can have the same equation appearing in many different problems. For instance, this is a classical example. If you think to make a hole passing through the Earth from one side to the other, say North Pole to South Pole, so that you don't have to consider rotation, and you let something go down in this wheel, then you may ask which kind of motion is it. This is also in a letter of Newton that the first time he wrote down the wrong solution, and then clearly he was able to realize the right one. So if you take all into consideration, you see that this is just an harmonic motion, like if the mass was were connected to a spring. But clearly it comes from a gravitational law. So can be surprising that the same equation was appearing in different, very different contexts. Or, for instance, you can say measure pi by taking, say, a circle, to draw a circle in a piece of cardboard originally in the shape of a square. Then you cut the shape of the circle. You weight the circle with respect to the weight of the square, and the ratio of these two weights is exactly pi. This was a method used by Galileo to compute the integrals. Simply, he drew the function of a piece of a sheet of paper of cardboard, then he weighted the sheet, then he cut the shape of the curve he wanted to integrate. By weighting this shape again, he had the ratio of the area of the two curves. And for instance, this is still actual because, for instance, one of the possible use of quantum computers is that of integrating quantum problems, not simply because they are able to perform the computation, but simply because they obey the same fundamental rules. And so if you are able to map a quantum problem into a quantum problem that can be solved by a computer, not computing the numbers of the Schrödinger equation, for instance, but computing just the Schrödinger equation, you have the solution of your original problem. And for instance, this is a kind of integrator of seven, if I remember well, differential equation by means of wheels things like that. And this was the tide predictor by Lord Kelvin. Lord Kelvin invented a lot of things. For instance, he participated in the set down of the first transatlantic telephone cable. And so this was a way of integrating the tides and plot them on a sheet of paper, which was extremely interesting at that time. And clearly, on the opposite side, the use of an analog computer, for instance, is to reproduce hydrodynamics in small scale, like it is done here in the engineering and the engineering faculty in the bottom, in the basement. They have a long pool, essentially, where they can produce waves and study how they behave. Clearly, the idea in this case is just to scale up things so that you can have the same equation, but some in reduced size. All of this, I mention all this because the first approach to computation was just that of having an analog mechanical or even electric or electronic device that implemented using some analog technique the differential equation you wanted to integrate. For instance, this we shall meet again Van der Waals in the following, but he built a machine able to, in some sense, to be programmed to integrate all kind of linear differential equation up to, I don't remember how many, but a lot of them. And integrate the result. Another way of integrating, for instance, the differential, actually this was performing integrals, can be used for integrating also differential equations, was the Kelvin integrator, which is rather interesting. So if you see, there is a disk which is spinning at constant speed. So imagine you have an engine below that makes these things spin at a constant speed. So the tangential speed of this disk is proportional to the radius, to the distance from the center. Then you have this ball, or this pair of balls, that can be moved using this lead at a certain distance from the center. And so they turn at a different velocity according to the distance from the center, using this gear here. And then they made rotate also this cylinder at the top, which was then used to record the number of turns and then to perform the integral. So the idea is the following. If you, using this gear, you move the set of balls nearer or farther than the center, for instance, in an harmonic way or as whichever function you want, then the number of turns made by the cylinder is proportional to the integral of this curve. And so this is a way of performing integrals so mechanically. And for instance, one can think that massive computation is a modern idea, but this is, for instance, a device designed and not implemented by this Lewis Fry Richardson for making weather predictions. So the idea was to have a lot of offices that you can see here, corresponding to different places on the Earth. They all had a telegraph line receiving information of weather condition in this point. Then they communicated this to, okay, essentially they shared this information with neighboring one implementing some kind of a partial differential equation and communicating also with the center that maybe could give the rise of the sun in some point and so on. And so the idea was to use this to have a weather forecast, which already at the beginning of the 20th century was realized to be a global problem, not a problem that can be solved locally. And so, for instance, it was tested, and you see that the method was tested, and after 6 weeks of works, it was able to predict the weather 6 hours after the observation, which is not so bad. You have just to scale this. So this was a project because with this result, he was able to forecast that having 200 human calculators, he could do real-time prediction. But clearly, the end of analog computer is by using this operational amplifier, which are generally at least a couple of transistors that have, say, an infinite voltage gain. And so having an infinite voltage gain, they cannot be used essentially as amplifiers because it always goes to saturation. But since it is also fast, it reaches the stationary state in a small interval of time, you can use it as a feedback system, like in this configuration here. So you have a certain voltage, no? And then you have essentially, since it has an infinite gain, it absorbs no current from the input, because essentially, as soon as it absorbs a current, it gives such a big current in the output that will be propagated in order to stop the input, since it is connected to the minus, the pin. And so essentially you can assume that these two pins are grounded, so the minus and plus, which is grounded, also the minus is grounded. And then you can see that the voltage out is connected to the voltage in by the ratio of these two resistance. And so essentially you have a way of multiplying your voltage in, changing sign, by simply changing these two resistors. Then if you instead insert a capacitor instead of the resistance, you can have either integral or the derivative of your signal. And so you can build up circuit like this, which give you essentially immediately the solution of a differential equation. When I was young, I visited in Pisa one researcher who was specialized in doing this kind of circuits. And so essentially, at that time, it was much faster to have him to select the wires in order to integrate the differential equation, then press the power on button, have the result on the oscillator, then to write down all these parameters on a computer waiting for the result and so on. But if you want to play, again, there is a way of, say, simulating any circuit including the operational devices. So here they are. So you can have also chaotic circuits simulated using operational amplifiers and so on, which is chaos means simply integrating a differential equation which is producing chaos. Okay, so this is from the background of what can be done with analytical computers, and from the point of view of business, the idea of having a scientific computing service is also quite old. In the 1825, and the offices, and also as we shall see, the defense started requiring a lot of computations. And so the idea was to contract somebody to have this service. And so the idea was the idea of having people able to perform a computation or to have a machine performing computation was essentially in the air at that time, and this was the time when this Howard Aiken, which was doing a PhD on vacuum tubes, but it has nothing to do what he did with the vacuum tubes, he needed to integrate a lot of differential equations to study how vacuum tubes behaved, and so he started thinking about building a machine for doing that. So he was discussing to have something like the Bush integrator when he met one of the technicians of his department saying, why do you want to build something that is already in the attic of our department? So he went there and he discovered the fragment of the Babbage differential engine who had been donated by Babbage's son to the University of Harvard some I don't know 50 years before, and who was still there. So Aiken was inspired by this and decided to abandon vacuum tubes and to build up a computer machine, and he developed this Mark I, which was an electromechanical calculator about some 4 tons with a motor of several kilowatts that read the instruction from a perforated paper tape. But for instance, he had no conditional jumps, so all calculation had to be, say, written down without having the possibility of making branches. Clearly, it could wrap the paper type in a circle, in an annulus, so to repeat the calculation, this was possible, but not, say, stop the calculation when a certain condition was reached. You see that it could do three sums per second and a multiplication each second. It was not really faster than human computers, but it could run, say, for weeks without stopping. And you can see that also the idea of the paper tapes were essentially that of the Jacquard loom, that of Babbage, without the possibility of doing if them or do while. And so clearly these are important because if you want, I don't know, to compute the integral, you have to perform a computation for a several number of steps, which can also be unwound on a paper tape. But if you want to stop when you have reached a certain precision, you need the conditional branches. So essentially, since the money comes from IBM, IBM wanted to make the things look also like an IBM machine. So Watson insisted on having nice case, very solid, not to appear like a product of a researcher. But but it seems that when it was presented, Eichen took all the credit, not citing IBM. So Watson decided to produce its own computer. Anyhow, this machine was used by von Neumann to perform some computation about the atomic bomb. Another aspect that also is important, you have seen probably the movie, you know, the Imitation Game about the Enigma machine. Clearly, during the Second World War was clearly a big push to introduce computers. One of the problems was to decode the Enigma code, to break the Enigma code, which was, in some sense, simple, because it was based on Caesar code. Caesar code is quite simple. You have just to have a drum or a circle where you have letters corresponding to the same letters on the outside. You turn this wheel by an angle, a certain number of steps, and then instead of, when you read the letter on one of these circle, and you write down the letter corresponding in the other one. So you have a scrambling of letters, which can be clearly quite easily broken by analysis of frequency. And it is also, if you read Sherlock Holmes, in one of his adventures, he found a message with a lot of figures, say, stylized humans wearing flags in some position, and so he broke the code simply looking at the most common figure. It was an E, and then after some time you can find an R, and then you can decipher all the code. But clearly, in order not to be broken easily, the idea is to turn each times that you code a letter, you also change the encoding of the next letter. And this is how the Enigma worked. So programming the Enigma meant to how to change the code for each letter, clearly with a certain number of combinations, and then coming back to the end. And so clearly, according to the number of gears, you can have a different combination, and so the combination started to explode. Clearly, as you can see also in the movie, there was a lot of hints. For instance, the Polish resistance was able to capture one of these Enigma, another was found in a U-boat. Then they saw that there are repetitions in the message, because one way of breaking a code is to have the same message in clear and coded, and so that you can have a lot of information on how the coding was done. So for instance, the Secret Services, the English Secret Services, sometimes let the German spy to have some very important information just to see how they coded this information, how they transmitted this information to the central office in order to have the same message clear and coded. And the contribution of Alan Turing was to build an electromechanic, not computer actually, it was just a generator of combination. It was able to simulate in parallel 36 Enigma machines, and so quite in a relatively small time, so that by eliminating part of the possibilities, and then using brute force you could say the code, the message. This was the Colossus. Finally, let me pass to the second part, how real computer was invented. But before, I would like to ask you if you have questions, comments, if you can understand what I say, if you can see everything. Is it all okay with you? Because I always fear that nobody is listening to me. Okay, they say that, okay, at least somebody is following us. Okay, okay, perfetto. So, I said that the Second World War was a real push because, first of all, it required a lot of computation to produce shooting tables. So we shall see in the following how these are done to the deciphering codes. And also, one of the fields that pushed a lot computation was, from one side, the production of atomic bomb, but the other, the radars. That was one of the main factors that promoted the winning, especially the resistance of the English field, because the German, the Goering was of the idea of being always the offensive, so German should conquer. So the radar was seen as a defense medium, and German did not want to say to show to the rest of the world that they were defending themselves. So they adopted very late the idea of radars, while the UK troops used a lot to defend themselves from bombing. One of the central points for developing computers was this Moore School. So since there was a high demand of computation for firing tables means to integrate differential equation that take into consideration air resistance and also latitude because of the Coriolis force. So you have to keep in consideration the angle, so not only the angle or the elevation angle and the power of your gun, but also the latitude angle, in order to compute the Coriolis force and to see where the gun will arrive, and clearly air resistance. And so each firing table for a single type of gun included about 3,000 trajectories. Each of them have to be computed, I don't know in how many steps, integrating the differential equation. So clearly, this required a month of work for a 100 human computers, or for the Bush mechanical differential analyzer, who was in the basement of this Moore School. And in the Moore School, it was a girl school, because at that time, and for many times, those who computed were essentially girls, because for two reasons. First of all, because they were at hand while men were in the front, and then because it was considered, since it was essentially making use of these hand calculators, it was very near to the idea of typing machine, which was again the classical school, classical girl work. At that, a bit before, vacuum tubes had been developed by following an observation of Edison, who noticed that the bulbs of his lamp tend to become darker on one side, which was quite strange, no? Because you had this filament with the current inside, it become glowing, but the only one side of the bulb was becoming dark. The fact was that, first of all, he used direct current, not alternating current like nowadays. And then, because at the time, it used the vacuum inside instead of, say, argon gas or inert gases. So, generally, when you have a filament which is incandescent, so very hot, it emits electrons that normally in air they advance for a small distance and then are reabsorbed. But in vacuum, they are free to move. And since there is a resistance in the filament, there is a difference of voltage between the two ends of the filament, essentially between the two wires that brings electricity to the filament. And so, since you have this difference of voltage, electrons are pushed from the negative wire towards the positive one. They miss this one, and so they impact into the glass, and they darken the glass there. So clearly, considering this, he started to have an idea, okay, well, what happens if I put the grid here so that I can modulate this emission? So these were the first valves, diodes, essentially built using lamps with additional wires. And the idea is to have a filament which is emitting electrons at a different voltage from, say, an anode, and in the middle, eventually, a grid, or not. If you don't put the grid, you have just a diode. If you put a grid, you have a triode, which can modulate current. And here is... Okay, there is a nice movie by Veritasium, which is an interesting channel, in which tells how this invention was developed, if you are interested. So, vacuum tubes were quickly produced, so essentially this is a standard arrangement. You have this cathode here, which is a headed filament. Then you have the grid, the control grid, the anode, the glass tube. Essentially, normally you don't see all of this, because in the tube there are some metal that absorbs the rest of the air, and which is generally coated on the glass. So essentially, when you look at the valve, normally you don't see this except from the above, but it looks shiny because of the coating inside of the valve. And in 1937, the first vacuum tube computer was developed, still not programmable, still dedicated to solving differential systems of differential equations, but using binary arithmetic and also capacitors for memory, which is something which is clearly an innovation with respect to the mechanical computer. And you see again a device like the ones that I showed before. This is a punch card reader. This is the first stage of the Olivetti Elea 6001, which if you are interested, you can visit in this high school in the near Arezzo. This is the Elea. We shall come back to this. You see the control panel, no keyboard. You see tapes, like here, and the These are the racks with the logic cards. It means that each of these cards had one circuit, I think 2 bits. So, but the input of the data input to be transferred to tapes and then to the computer was this IBM card reader, which had this part here removable, where the programming of this, not the whole computer, the programming of this was done in hardware by changing the wiring. And so the one of the main contributions to the theory of computation was the Turing machine, which was not the source of, as we have seen, the source of the first computers. First computers were for integrating differential equations. But in the meantime, Turing realized that you could have a machine who can be programmed to do whichever task, essentially by means of a program which in the Turing machine is not stored on the tape. The tape is only for data. The program has to be stored somewhere. And you can play, if you want, with the Turing machine, which is interesting. The idea is that you have symbols on your tapes, and the program that the machine is a state machine. So the program is like this. If you read the one and you are in state A, write a two, or no, the opposite. If you read you are in state one and you read an A, go state two and delete what is in the tape, or advance to the next step. So, for instance, this is a program for swapping A and B. So essentially, so you have a sequence of A and B, and this is a program that say, okay, if you are in this state and you read, if you are state zero, which is the beginning, and you read an A, go to state one and write a B. Then if you are in state zero, still here, and you have a B in, go to state one. If you go to state one, so you are here, so you are in state one, you read the B, then do nothing and move to the right. And now go to state zero and go to the right. If you are in state zero and see a B, go to state one and write an A, and then you advance to the next, and so on. So at the end, it changes all A to B and all B to A. Or you can have some more complex task, which you can play by hand. Or again, you can look, I have not put it here, but clearly on the web, you have a lot of sites implementing Turing machines. Okay, so let's come back to the Moore School. They were working on ballistics, but also on radars. And the problem of radars was that they were able to see things, but in general they see too much, because if you just keep the rays that are reflected by something, you see clearly the ships and the planes of your enemy, but you see also the sea, the mountains, everything which is there. So the idea was to develop something able to take the difference between two images and show only the difference, which were the moving part, so probably the ships and the airplanes and so on. And so the idea was to develop the ley line, some kind. For instance, one which was used then also for computers was a mercury dry line. So essentially you had a tube, a pipe full of mercury with something that emitted the sound, so the excitation from one side. This excitation traveled the pipe at a certain speed, which is high, but not so high as the speed of light. So you have a detector at the end. And so with this delay line, you need to have a way of copying back the signal to the beginning. So according to the length of your delay line and the speed of traveling of information there, you can store a certain number, a certain amount of information. Then this information can be fed back to the system in order to just to store. Copied somewhere if you want to read it, or replaced by other signal if you want to write down this kind of memory. And clearly, for the radar, you just needed a fixed shift, which was essentially the time that the beam was able to come back to the same point, and an inverter just to subtract what was stored at the beginning to what was shown. So essentially the line had to be large enough to contain the information on the screen, all this information, and then when you come back, you, instead of plotting the information received, you plot the difference between what you received in this moment and what you have received the swap before. Clearly, you could also use vacuum tubes, but vacuum tubes were extremely expensive. So you use them for amplifier, detector, subtractor, and so on, but not for storing information. And so when you remember, these were working in the Moore School, they proposed a big machine with 5,000 tubes. Actually, at the end, there were about 18,000, and to make a computation. And the problem is that clearly, with this large amount of tubes, where that if you don't know, you take a time before breaking of this tube of say some tens hours or some hundred hours, you have one of them breaking each minute or something like this. Not all of them are stressed. So one of the big steps to be solved before building this kind of computer was how to have these tubes more reliable. Clearly, you can improve the way of building them. But then it was discovered that, first of all, if you use them at low voltage, so with a small difference of voltage, they last much longer because essentially the filament is not breaking like a lamp. Imagine that you have to switch on and off things. Then the other solution was to keep the machine on all the time, because it was noticed that these tubes used to break when they were switched on by in the heating phase. And so this was enough to have computers working. And so we are now, you see, 1944, so in the middle of the war. And so this was the first computer, ENIAC. It was also used by von Neumann too, because von Neumann was looking for every way of integrating things that could be used for the bomb. But again, this was not a programmable computer. So, because essentially cards were too slow and the tubes were so fast that you could not store program on the cards, the idea of storing in the computer was not yet so developed. And so the idea was to use a hardwired program, essentially like we have seen in the card reader, to program the order of operation. And now the problem that von Neumann was trying to solve is not that simply differential equation, but of a partial differential equation, which is a much harder problem. I hope that all of you are more or less familiar with the mathematics below this concept. In case I have sketched here some idea, but I don't want to review all of them. But essentially the idea is that now instead of iterating one or a few variables, say x, x dot, x dot dot, and so on, you have to iterate a whole field of numbers. So you have to iterate a lot of numbers. For instance, if you are computing diffusion equation, you have your quantity defined on a vector, say certain number of storing conditions, and you have to update all of them at the same time according to the old values, because all of them is obeying some function that says how this the local data is transformed, plus what happened nearby. And so this was the machine, the ENIAC. Again, you see a lot of women working in these computers, the first computers, because again, first of all, men were mainly in the front, and also because it was estimated that women were more, say, comfortable when you have to deal with delicate things. You see numbers that of cubes to be changed every while. Clearly, they had also to develop a way of identifying the failing tube quickly, because otherwise it is a problem. So one, if you want to have an idea of the complexity of running a computer at the time, at least, you may think that the general way of storing one bit is using a flip-flop. A flip-flop is a device that stays in the same state until you receive a given signal and you switch at the opposite. So if you go here, you see an article where the author tried to rebuild something that behaves like a flip-flop using tubes of the epoch and a lot of batteries here, because they work at about 100 volts. So he did not want to have a 100 generator, and so he used a lot of batteries in order to have 100 volts, or 200, I don't remember how many. He says that clearly he could have access to the original wiring, but still he had to tinker a lot in order to have this work. This is for just one bit. So this is not a task for the faint of heart. I also had a look to the original drawing, and if you look how it works, you see that there are these chains of flip-flops, so essentially one bit each, but they are arranged in a way which is like the Pascal calculator. The Pascal calculator is like this. You have these wheels, you set the first number, say 452 or what you want. Then you have to add another number, and for instance, 3, 2, 4, then you turn this four position in advance, then these two, and then this, I don't remember what I said, C3. And automatically they carry the number to the wheel above or to the wheel below, when it is needed. So this is how it works. Clearly works well. But today, if you look carefully, you see that this is exactly doing the same things using decimal wheels. So they use 10 bits just to store one decimal digit. Clearly, this is a waste of flip-flops, because with 10 bits you can store 1,024 numbers, not just 10 digits. But clearly, this is what people had. Clearly, this is what also how the Babbage engine worked. And so Aiken, who inspired with by Babbage, was inspired by Babbage and Pascal probably, simply copied what Babbage and Pascal did on computer, on vacuum tubes. And clearly, von Neumann was delighted to discover that they had this computer available. Then he started participating, and as we shall see in the next lesson, because I think you are enough tired, I am. he started thinking seriously how a computer should behave, and he will end up with the von Neumann architecture of a computer. I think after 80 slides, we can stop here for today. And clearly, if you have questions, comments, or if you discover other aspects related to this history of computers, let me know that clearly I can integrate into the slides. I shall please fill the form so that I can communicate to all of you where the recordings and the slides will be put in the next days. So, if you have comments or questions, please go on. Otherwise, I can stop recording. No questions? Okay. So I.